monsters from mythology, monsters from the depths of the ocean, monsters from outer space, and monsters you couldn't imagine even in your worst dreams.
Now, I don't know what it is or where it came from.
Well, we don't know what it is or where it came from either. But stay with us, and we'll try to find out.
And bolt your doors.
If you want to survive in a monster movie, there's some basic rules to observe. Rule number one, don't snoop around in strange places because you never know what'll pop up. Another basic rule, don't poke around with foreign objects. This blob of protoplasmic substance is just waiting for some poor fool to pick it up. And once that movie blob tastes human flesh, it wants more and more. Fascination with monsters goes back to the early days of the movies. The 1920 German film, The Golem, set the style for the man-created Hulk, Frankenstein being the prime example, who gets out of hand and runs amok. It's essential, of course, for the monster to get out of hand. It's no fun if he turns out to be a harmless oaf. Another German film, Nosferatu, in 1922, was the trailblazer for Dracula. This gothic classic about ghouls who live on human blood still casts a chilling spell. In his novel, The Lost World, Arthur Conan Doyle amazed his readers with his story of a prehistoric beast on the rampage in London. Moviegoers in 1925 were even more amazed to see the novel come to life on the screen. And movie makers were quick to realize that the screen was the perfect medium for this kind of scare fantasy. From here onwards, every imaginable kind of monster would turn up on film, and with ever-increasing impact as film techniques improved. By 1960, when The Lost World was remade, filmmakers had arrived at an incredible degree of reality with their hideous beasts.
Eaten alive.
Genius of science fiction, Jules Verne, proved to be a gold mine for film producers. His stories, like Journey to the Center of the Earth, challenged Hollywood's talents. Here, the beasts are actual lizards, with makeup and photographed with special lenses to make them seem huge and horrible. It's a safe bet that Jules Verne would be amazed to see how the movies have brought his monsters to life.
Safely be a
assume that 2 million years ago, this Brontosaurus and other ancient reptiles roamed the Earth. During this period, there was another species which we may call the intermediary animal, a cross between the land-living and the sea-living animals. Let us call this creature Godzilla, according to the legend of Oda Island.
A shattering impact in monster movies was made in 1956 by a Japanese entry. This imaginative exercise in fantasy fright made Godzilla a household word. There were a dozen sequels and countless imitations.
George, here in Tokyo, time has been turned back 2 million years. This is my report as it happens. A prehistoric monster the Japanese call Godzilla has just walked out of Tokyo Bay.
For its producers, Godzilla was a bonanza. Made in Tokyo on a modest budget with a local cast, the producers decided to hire Raymond Burr for its American version, filming his scenes in Hollywood and splicing them into the original. It was a decision that made rich men of Godzilla's creators. Godzilla was not, as many people assumed, a mechanical monster, but an actor in a foam rubber suit striding around miniature sets.
May I suggest that we spread out and try to determine the size and shape?
Right. Spread out, everybody. We're going to try to figure out the shape of this thing.
Ancient history has been a rich source of movie monsters. But today, producers realize that the space age offers even greater possibilities.
Holy cats. Hey. It's almost...
Yeah. Almost a perfect...
It is. It's round.
We finally got one.
We found a flying saucer.
Yes, but can you cope with whatever may be inside it? In the 1951 film, The Thing, eager scientists discover a spaceship in the Arctic, but they find its passenger is a murderous hulk who takes a lot of getting rid of. Conventional weapons are useless against this one. Other ways to destroy it must be found, and quick.
It's right in the middle, sir.
Incidentally, beneath all that monstrous makeup is a famous actor in the early stages of his career, the star of TV's Gunsmoke and How the West Was Won, James Arness. Monsters from outer space can take any form, even a triffid.
A what?
A triffid. The original triffid, the kind I saw in a greenhouse several years ago, was known to have come to Earth in a meteorite.
In the day of the triffids, Kieran Moore and Janet Scott find themselves trapped in a lighthouse by triffids. Like most objects from outer space, at least according to Hollywood, triffids like to devour actors. It's always a matter of finding the right weapon, and in time. So far, all the standard ones have failed. George Lucas's dazzling and brilliant look into the future, Star Wars, space travel is likely to bring us into contact with all kinds of monsters. Some of them will be very friendly. And on the other hand, just like people, some won't be friendly at all.
Hey, we don't serve their kind here.
What?
You're droids.
Bones. They'll have to wait outside. We don't want them here.
So why don't you wait out by the speeder? We don't want any trouble.
I positively agree with you, sir.
In a moment, you'll meet Hollywood's master monster maker, along with his collection of pets.
Fierce to be, can't be noticed the keenest. One of the family Formicidae.
An ant.
An ant?
Yes. A fantastic mutation. Probably caused by lingering radiation from the first atomic bomb.
These gorgeous but lethal clouds don't inspire much confidence, except perhaps to movie producers, who can conveniently blame the atomic age for the appearance of anything bigger than a bread box, such as crabs grown to the size of elephants, tarantulas bigger than houses, a man, his hormones way out of balance, grown to terrifying proportions. And every last monstrous creation keeps movie audiences coming back for more. Them, produced in 1954, remains among the very best films to speculate on the possibilities of atomic error and side product. To get these startlingly realistic shots of the monster ants, the special effects crew built several dozen mechanical models with working parts and remote control. If you think they're frightening to look at, imagine acting with them.
Stop the firing! Ceasefire! No more explosives!
Are we too late?
Fortunately, we were in time.
Okay, burn them up.
Pat, if these monsters got started as a result of the first atomic bomb in 1945, what about all the others that have been exploded since then?
I don't know.
Nobody knows, Robert. When man entered the atomic age, he opened a door into a new world. What we'll eventually find in that new world, nobody can predict.
Dr. Brennan, I know what I am. What I become. Help me, Doctor, please!
Alfred, I beg you. It's too late to bring the dead back to life. But at least you can help him. Help correct a terrible mistake.
Mistake? You dare call a scientific triumph a mistake?
Yes, Doctor, we do. You should have known that when you invent a potion that changes a teenager into a werewolf, it can only lead to problems. And you're about to face a big one.
Tony! Tony!
That teenage werewolf, by the way, is Michael Landon, long before he struck his bonanza or built his little house on the prairie.
Had their field day, one thing will be clear. It's not for man to interfere in the ways of God.
Hurry, darling. It will work.
And yet another misguided genius doctor, using his skill to change matter from one form to another. These experiments, at least in the movies, always go awry. Among the most startling errors, the one about the doctor who inadvertently changes himself into a fly. He thinks he can reverse the process.
It has worked. You'll be all right now. I know it's worked!
are monsters created by mistake. Take a look now at some monsters created with great skill and patience by just one man. The dinosaur in 1 million BC. The double-headed rock in the seventh voyage of Sinbad. This thing from the depths. And the harpies in Jason and the Argonauts. What these monsters all have in common is this man, Ray Harryhausen, Hollywood's foremost inventor of movie monsters. Ray Harryhausen, a wizard of animation and special effects, an artist extraordinary whose skill and imagination has won him a special place in film history. Together with his partner, producer Charles Schneer, they have devised some astounding fantasy adventures. In the seventh voyage of Sinbad, two great beasts, the Cyclops and the Dragon, battle to the death. How was it done? Let's ask the man who did it, Ray Harryhausen.
Well, Tom, for the benefit of That's Hollywood, I'll let you in on a few secrets. There are several processes we use, including double exposure. We film the actors first and fit the monsters in later to synchronize with the action. As I recall, it took about 2 months to film this sequence. The dragon is actually about 2.5 feet long, and the Cyclops is about 13 inches tall.
In Jason and the Argonauts, a classic fantasy film based on Greek mythology, the hero comes across this fantastic creature, Hydra, the multi-headed serpent, surely one of the most complicated sequences to film.
This took almost 3 months to film. As you can see, each head moves independently, and every movement is filmed frame by frame. This is called the stop motion process. As you know, there are 16 frames to each foot of film, and we seldom get more than 1 foot of film per day. That's why a sequence averages about, 1 month of filming for every 1 minute on the screen.
In another sequence of Jason and the Argonauts, the adventurers fight a gigantic bronze statue come to life, Talos. Mr. Harryhausen, Talos looks enormous. Just how big was he?
Well, he really wasn't very big. He was actually about 13 inches in height. But for the purpose of the story, we had to make him look enormous. The concept was based on the Colossus of Rhodes. Talos, like all the monsters in our pictures, is a completely jointed figure, ball and socket joints as in a skeleton. And his skin is a flexible substance, a rubberized type of material. The close-ups on the heel are separately constructed sets. According to Greek mythology, the only way this metal monster could be killed was by letting out his life's blood, his molten metal, by a tap in his heel.
Also in Jason and the Argonauts, one of the most incredible confrontations ever put on the screen, the battle with the skeletons.
Destroy them!
This is probably the most complicated fight I've ever staged because of the number of skeletons involved and the fact that each one has a head, a torso, two arms, and two legs to move. Again, it's a frame-by-frame job. And once we have it completed, it has to be synchronized to the actions of a previously photographed actor. It's a little confusing for the actors sometimes as they have to perform against invisible opponents, like shadow boxing. And I imagine they are rather amazed to see the end product.
And in Mysterious Island, the survivors of a wreck stumble across an enormous crab. Ray Harryhausen, that's a mighty convincing-looking crab.
Well, Tom, I'll have to make a confession. That's a real crab, but a dead one. There are some things in nature you just can't do better than nature herself. We made the crab suitable for stop-motion photography in the same way that we do with the man-made monsters. And I must make another confession. I spent so much time with my monsters that I get rather fond of them. But they are always the villains, and they always have to lose. Still, we try to give them a bit of pathos, so that you feel a little sorry for them when they die.
Thank you, Ray Harryhausen, for letting us in on some of your tricks. And keep those monsters coming, no matter how badly actors treat them.
That's the best crab I ever cooked.
Well, monster fans, that's Hollywood.